Hey, I'm Namish. I'm an AI educator and founder. And you would have heard this term very recently called MCP. It has been making a lot of waves. It has always been around, but recently people have been embracing it a lot more. Let me explain it to you what it is, how does it work, and how you can use it in your everyday coding with tools like Cursor or Windsurf. Feel free to jump to the last part if you are more interested in how you can use them. But you would be able to use them much more better if you understand what they are and how they work. So MCP is basically a layer between all your apps like Slack, email, or browser, or any other app like a database, and your agent, basically Cursor, Windsurf, or any other tool like ChatGPT desktop. So this is a layer that sits between both of them, and it helps them communicate with each other in a bi-directional way. So now your agent, which is Cursor in this case, can see what is happening in Slack, email, and browser. And what happened in the past is if you set it up for one of these agents to communicate with Slack or email, but when you share it online, for example, if you want to share it with someone else, the entire configuration goes away. So MCP has made it possible that the entire configuration stays the same way, and you can share it with anyone else, or you can also sell it publicly. But if you know about APIs, the first question in your head would be, how is it different from APIs? MCPs are built for an AI-first world. There are two major differences between an API and an MCP. Let me explain. MCPs are dynamic. So what happens with APIs is, in APIs, you have fixed endpoints. Let's say you are using Twitter's API. So there would be a fixed API call that lets you post using that API. Or there would be a fixed API call for making a comment. But with MCPs, this entire configuration is dynamic. The Twitter API will now communicate with your agent like Cursor, telling it that what all the API can do. And you don't have to set them up specifically, because the MCP itself will have the entire configuration that the agent needs. Use the server, in this case, which would be Twitter. And another benefit of using MCPs is it allows for two-way communication. So you can send information using this MVP, and you can also receive it. So let me explain using a very simple example. Let's say you went to a menu that has a fixed menu. They print out their menus and that menu remain the same. Let's say this restaurant now want to introduce some special dishes for the season. For example, if there is any specific fruit that is available in the region during that time, they want to add it to the menu. But they cannot, because they have a fixed menu. They would have to update the entire menu and get it print out, and only then the menu can be changed. But MCP is sort of a dynamic menu where the chef, whatever the new dish they want to add to the menu, they can do it instantly. And not just that, it's two way. So if you would want any specification in the dish, for example, if you would want extra spices in your dish, then you can communicate that through that interface itself. That's how MCPs are different and how they would enable you to do so much more in this AI first world. So if you are building anything using AI, or if you are using AI in any app that you're building, this is a must. So this allows you to do so much more with a simple configuration. That's why MCPs is such a big buzzword right now. So there's an official website of MCP where they specify, where they show how exactly it works. On your host or the MCP client, this could be anything like Cursor, Windsurf, or Claude. This would be communicating with the MCP server. And this MCP server would then be connecting with the service that you're using. And this service could be something on your local device, or this could be something that is remote. Now let me show you what all MCPs are available and how you can use it with your local setup like Cursor or Windsurf. So there's this website called smithri.ai. Over here you can see all the MCP servers that are available right now. All of these are basically specialized tools that now you can call within your Cursor or Windsurf environment itself. So basically this GitHub MCP allows you to update your repository, search repositories or fork repositories directly from your Cursor chat. So you might be thinking that all of these things were already possible if you use the terminal. Yes, but now all of these tools are available with the agent mode itself. So it can do it itself. It can directly make those connections. And please note, these are two-way connections. So it can directly read the information. It can edit that information. And it can add all of these files to its own context. So that makes it so much more powerful. So I will show you how to use this within Cursor in a minute. But let me show you a couple of more MCPs that would be so helpful. Another very common use case when you are coding with Cursor is that you would have to debug the app that Cursor has made. And for that, you have to constantly run that app on your local system. You would have to check the console logs for the error that are happening. You would have to check the local storage of the app. All of these things just adds a lot of friction when you are debugging something with Cursor. But now you can use these MCP servers like browser use, through which Cursor can directly see that what is within the console log. If you are not sure what it is, when you click on inspect here, on the right you will see this console where everything that is happening on the backend or every function that is failing shows up. So this helps a lot when you are debugging your code with Cursor. So all of these functionalities are now possible using these MCPs. Now let me show you how you can set it up and how to use it in your everyday workflows. So I'm inside Cursor right now. I opened up the settings tab over here. You can go on the top right for opening this. And within this, I would do specifically two things. One is I will add the MCP server, and apart from that, I will turn on the YOLO mode, because MCP servers works best on YOLO mode because you don't have to continuously give it permissions to do certain things. I will show you in a minute how you can do both of them and what I mean by enabling the YOLO mode here. I'm gonna use this MCP server called browser tool here. I will drop the link for it in the description below. Check it out from there. So the first thing you have to do is you have to install the Chrome extension for using it. I already downloaded it here. You can download it from here and it would give you a zip file that you would have to open up and then you would have to install it. So for installing this Chrome extension, you would have to go to this manage extension settings. I will go to manage extensions and I will click on load unpacked. So this would basically open up my file selector. I've unzipped the zip folder that I just downloaded. So I will just click on this and I will select this. This would load the MCP server here. Another thing I would do is I will just pin this here so that we can also see it. But you don't have to do anything apart from this. Now this extension is working fine. The second thing we have to do is we have to install MCP within our Cursor as well. So it also shows you the steps on how to do it. So we have to copy this command from here. I will add new MCP server here. I will paste this command here and I will give this a server name. So over here, I will add the name of the server and I will add this. So this is enabled right now. So as you saw, this basically took a moment and then it got the list of all the commands that are available within this MCP server. This is exactly how an MCP works, where all the endpoints or all the things that are possible with the MCP are communicated by the MCP in the real time. And these are all the things it can do right now. Seeing console logs, all the errors, all the network logs, taking a screenshot of the screen. This is also one of the things you have to do consistently when you're coding with Cursor, that you show the screenshots of how the product is looking right now. And then running a SEO audit and all of these things. So once you have set up this MCP server, the next step for you is to get started with the YOLO mode. So when you go on the features tab over here, you will see that there's this YOLO mode and by default, this is turned off. But turning it on will make the development so much more faster for you. A lot of people are scared or skeptical about it because after you enable this, Cursor can implement a lot of things itself. It does not verify or ask you before executing that. But if you can use it the right way, this will also make the development so much faster for you. The most important thing over here to steer it in the right direction is having commands in the deny list. So these are basically the commands that you don't want it to run ever. And these are the commands which you should be actually scared of, because once you enable the YOLO mode, then it has ability to delete your files. Then it has ability to run URLs, terminal commands that can also give way for viruses to come in or make your software unsecured. So that's why I've put in a lot of commands over here that limits its ability to do any of those things. Plus, you can also keep this toggle turned on, so that way cursor can never delete any files from your program. I will just drop all of these commands in the description below. You can get it from the document. You can also see that what all of these are actually doing, and then you can add them on your deny list. But enabling YOLO mode is such a big advantage right now. I would recommend all of you to do it. Now that we have this MCP installed, let's see that how we can use it while debugging or while interacting with our browser. So I will just copy this command from the documentation, that is for running this MCP server locally. I will copy this and I will drop this in my terminal. So when I do that, this will start running locally, and this would be monitoring everything that comes on our browser through the extension that we just downloaded. Now I will open up another terminal and I will start running my project locally as well. I will put in the command here, npm run dev. This would start running my repository on the local terminal. I will come on this link and now my project is running. This is one of the projects that I've been making. What this lets you do is it lets you post on X and Blue Sky at once. When you're making an app, there is a lot of debugging that you constantly have to do. You have to constantly look at the logs. You have to look at the errors that is happening along the way. For doing that, you have to use developer tools a lot. So when I click on inspect, this will open up these developer tools on the right, which basically shows everything that is happening on the backend. This will show the console, which shows any error that comes up while this app is running. Then there are things like storage and everything else. But over here, there's this new tab added called Browser Tools MCP. So through this MCP is now capturing all the details within our console, within the browser. This can also capture a screenshot. You can define the address where you would want to save these screenshots. By default, they are saved in your downloads folder right now. And this shows the server port on which this is running. So you don't have to change anything over here. What this allows you is that your debugging becomes very simple. So now you don't have to capture a screenshot from here and paste it in the cursor. It can do all of this itself. So for example, if I ask it, can you see the screen I am browsing? And let's say if I want to, tweak this grid on the background. As you can see right now, this grid is not on the entire screen. It's just on some of these parts. So I will ask it, can you see the screens I'm browsing? How can I extend the grid to the entire page? One thing I do while using the YOLO mode is I ask it to give me the entire plan of implementation before it actually implements it, so that I can just review the entire plan in the first prompt where it just tells me what it's gonna do. And then I just let it do the entire thing. Give me the plan first and then we will do the implementation in the next step. So it's called the MCP tool here and it took the screenshot. Then it's going through my entire repository to see that which files are basically impacting this page. And the benefit of using the YOLO mode over here is that you don't have to approve all of these requests one by one. This happens on itself. Just makes the speed of development so much faster. It identified the file that is actually enabling that grid pattern in the background. It showed the plan what it has to do. Now all I just have to do is just approve this and it will do the entire thing. And you can also use it for major errors. So for example, I will show you one of the errors that I am debugging right now. So if I log in on this app, then I can go to the dashboard, and using this dashboard, anyone can post on multiple accounts. So one of the key features over here is that anyone has to link their account. So I am right now debugging the functionality of doing that with Blue Sky. So what happens right now is when you click on connect, it asks you to input your Blue Sky ID. So I will just do that. And when I click on sign in, this redirects me to the Blue Sky portal. Over here, I would have to put in my password. So when I put in my password, then it redirects me to a page where I can approve this request or deny this request. So I will just show you on the console what is happening. So when I do that on the console, there are some errors, but none of these errors are in direct reference to the app. So when I click on accept, then when I'm getting redirected, then I get this error where some part of the configuration fails. and the entire error is captured in the console log here. So if I have to debug this, then I can open up a new chart over here. I ask it to check the error that just happened and make a plan to debug it. I ask it to not execute these steps right now. But what happened in this case is I don't have to take a screenshot. I don't have to go and copy the console logs and explain the error to the chat over here. When I just send this prompt, it will do all of it itself. It will directly get the console log errors from the MCP tool. It will get all the network errors. It will take a screenshot all using the MCP tool. And then it will just go through the entire implementation to see that what all has happened. In this case, what happens is if you can just also make a file which has the context of your entire repository, then it makes the entire process much more faster. But even then, it identified the file where this error might be happening, where it's going through the entire file, seeing the implementation. And then it will give me a plan on how I can debug this, what might be the things where this implementation is failing. So now it made a plan of 7 steps that we have to do to verify what is causing this error and then fix it. And even while implementing these steps, it can just identify what is going wrong or what is right because it has control of my browser now. And just like that, you have so many more MCPs that are available for you right now. Things like sequential thinking, a Brave search basically, which can do a search using Brave's browser and connecting this with your Supabase directly. So all of these things make cursor so much more powerful, because now let's say if you would want to create a new table or change anything in your table, previously what you had to do was you had to send the commands using the CLI of Supabase, or you would have to put in SQL commands directly on Supabase. But now you can just connect it via using this MCP server, and it will give the entire access of your Supabase to this agent over here, and it can make the changes itself. So this adds a lot more depth to everything that you can do with using cursor right now, and all of this without having actual ability to write code. Even talking about the app that I just made, so I've created this entire app from scratch just using AI coding tools like Lovable and Cursor, and anyone can do it right now. This is one of the biggest opportunities right now. You can actually make apps as a non-developer, and things are just gonna get easier from here. With things like MCP and newer models coming along, if you just take action, if you get on it right now, then you would have opportunity to make apps to solve problems. And the best thing is, if you are watching this video, you are amongst a very niche set who are willing to learn this, who are willing to experiment. All of this is not even mainstream right now. I anyway share everything that I learn along the way on my YouTube channel. But if you want a deeper insight onto how I build this apps, what is the exact process, what are the prompts that I use along the way, you can get all of this. You can get this entire guide that includes everything that I learned from my trial and error over the last 6 months, where I created more than 13 apps. I failed at multiple places and I learned what is the right way of building with AI. This guide gives you the entire steps that you have to take to make your MVP yourself and convert that into an app once you get enough traction from the market. It also includes all the prompts that I use as well. Right now, this is in the early bird phase and the prices will increase after the first 100 sales. Right now, it's at 99. So the prices are gonna go up really soon. Do sign up if this is something that would help you. See you on the other side. Bye-bye.